Hello, 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 and welcome to another episode of The Collective Spotlight. This episode, we are going all in on some indie comics, not just talking about one singular issue, but we've got the co-publisher of Red 5 Comics. That some of you guys might know them from titles like Angela de la Muerte, The Box, Riptide, and many future titles like Carriers. But without further ado, we have Josh from Red 5. Josh, how are you doing today, dude?
I'm doing very well. Thanks for having me.
Heck yeah, man. Our good friend of the store, Travis Gibb, who most of our friends know, introduced us. And we have a co-publisher on the show again. It's always cool to talk on the publishing side a little bit.
Awesome. Well, I will explain anything that I can. Any questions anyone has about it?
Well, let's pretend everybody in here is like real new to it all. Just explain Red 5, like kind of what you guys' mission statement might be. And, you know, I mentioned a couple titles, but some of the titles you guys are kind of known for or some of your newer titles that you guys have out.
Yeah. So I guess, you know, the short version of it, and it's probably something every publisher would say, is our mission statement is to make like the awesome comics and the most cool comics. Hi, nice to meet you. We started Red 5 in 2007, so we're coming up on our 15th anniversary. Initially, the big book that it was known for was Atomic Robo. We were the original home of Atomic Robo until 2015. And then alongside that, we've done, you know, a bunch of different titles, each, you know, always looking, not any for one specific genre, but always looking for some sort of unique hook. So early on, one of the most popular books we did was Neozoic, which was a world where dinosaurs never went extinct and mankind evolved alongside them. It had some fantastic art and a really interesting story where people live without technology and fight off dinosaurs, but they still have politics and society and normal societal issues, but with dinosaurs. you know, we did this great, you know, like pay on to Pulp Adventures. We brought a character from the 30s called Moon Girl, not the Marvel character. She actually predates that character by quite a bit. She was actually created by the creator of Green Lantern back in the 30s for the publisher that eventually became EC Comics. She's in the public domain now, which is why we decided to do an updated take on her with some early work by Raza before he went off to do covers for Marvel. So it's entirely digitally painted by him, and it's a fantastic read and just a beautiful book. And now, you know, the last few years, we've really been expanding the catalog, expanding the titles we're carrying, and reaching out for some more stranger stuff. Hey, a Moon Girl fan, awesome. I love that book, I dearly do. In fact, it's on its third printing as a trade now, so go out and keep an eye out for it. So now, you know, obviously we had Angela Del Morte, like you were talking about, as part of a agreement that we made with an Argentinian studio to bring several books they had done in Argentina, translate them to English, and bring them to the U.S. market for the first time. So Angela's being created by a really, really talented writer-artist named Salvador Sanz. And he does a lot of heavy metal work as well as when he's, you know, making stuff for the Argentina market. Angela is like his first big epic about this woman who can send her or basically possess other creatures, other people, other animals. And she discovers that she's the forefront, that the experiment that's going to lead to an army of people that can do that so that its creator can take over the world. And she rebels against him. But it's both action-packed and cerebral at the same time and deeply strange, and I love it. And we have that fantastic prequel that we did as a large, oversized 8x11 with a 48-page story that so you can really get the sense of his art, because he did it at album size and an album about that size when he originally did it. So it's, you know, square, and we were trying to find like the perfect format for it so you could really get a sense of it here. He's just finished his newest series, which is a giant monster book called Mega, where the Earth begins to rebel against all these pesky humans that live on it that have been destroying it by growing giant monsters to get rid of them. And we're going to be doing that in a similar oversized edition with the first issue is going to be out in December. So it'll be in previews in another month or so. So keep your eyes out for it.
Awesome.
Yeah. At the same time, we did a book called Machine Girl with about a young young woman who's a cyborg warrior who's fighting in the fighting pits of Mars, has no memory, doesn't know how she got there, and is trying to figure out where she came from and who made her and why, so that she can kind of figure out what to do with her life. And we've done two volumes of Machine Girl so far, and there is a third volume on the way for anyone who was a fan of that book. We just wrapped up The Dark Age, which is probably one of my favorite books that we've put out since I joined Red 5, where all metal on Earth evaporates one day, and it takes basically all technology and society collapses and reduces mankind back to basically a feudal state where people have wooden clubs and stone axes and that sort of thing, and everyone starts to retreat back to kingdoms and fighting their old grudges against each other until suddenly the cause of what caused all the metal to go away and why is revealed, and people have to figure out what to do with that once they find out why it has all happened. So The Dark, and it ended with issue 7 that just came out a couple of months ago, so everyone take a look at that. And in stores now is my newest series, because besides publishing, I also write some of the titles as well. The Box, which is a detective story, a kind of a crime story with a magical twist, where you have a private detective who has discovered a magic box that you can take anything that you can imagine out of it and ask of it, it will give to you. And now he's framed for kidnapping by the mob, who are trying to force him to give up the box. And he's on the run from the police and trying to figure out how to both keep the box and clear his name without being killed by all these forces that are chasing after him.
What was really cool about The Box was, I don't know if you keep an eye on this type of stuff or not, but that one showed up on Key Collector, actually.
I think I heard that.
Really fast.
Awesome. That's great to hear.
Yeah. As a writer, and as a publisher, actually, and I know, there's so many sites and everything, you guys can't keep track of it, but what does it mean to you? Or like, what's the reaction when you do see, a Comic Tom or a Key Collector or somebody like that mention you guys? Because obviously to be mentioned in the same breath as Marvel or Boom or Image is got to be good for the brand, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's exactly that. It means we've kind of percolated up above, just for at least something has percolated up, because there's a lot of great books coming, especially on the indie scene. It's about as big now as it ever has been. And there's lots of really, I can't even keep track of all, everything that Scout and Source Point and Mad Cave and everybody's putting out great books. And it's hard to make any single one of them stand out. So when something like that happens, you get, that something has clicked with people, and it has, and you never know what it is entirely, but something has clicked and it's kind of percolated above the best, so that people know that they know that at least that book is there. And then hopefully they know Red 5 is there, and Red 5 is the kind of place where you can get really interesting, really cool books like that and come in and look for more. Like another series we had, it was very much along those lines. We had a great disaster story called Riptide that my co-publisher and co-owner Scott Chitwood wrote about an asteroid passes near the Earth, causes all the tides to recede and strands an ocean liner, a cruise ship, on the floor of the Gulf of Mexico, and all the survivors have to race to shore before the tide comes back in. So it's like a really interesting take on something like the Poseidon Adventure. And we thought it was just a cool idea. Like, that's kind of what we're looking for when we, I'm always like, somebody basically tells by us, what kind of books do you take? And I like their books that I think are fun and that I think are good. And after that, I'm hoping we can find an audience for them, and that there's that if I like it, somebody else is going to like it. But that was one of those ones where you go, this is a good idea, we're going to make it. And then next thing it's on like a Key Collector, and people are saying, you need to get this book. And it became, it sold out and became a super hot book. You always hope that's going to happen, but it's hard to predict.
Well, and next thing you also know is like, you've got to, because Riptide actually ended up becoming its like a sequel, right? Because the Draken one came out, and then so you guys, when you find that idea and then it's so successful that you could do a second volume or whatnot, I mean, that's got to be awesome for you as a co-publisher as well.
That's the goal. You want to get one of these things at least self-propelling enough that they can make it worthwhile to do, or fund the next one, so that you are and you can just keep going with them and keep going with them. And that one did really well. It was selling out, which is enough to know that there's enough interest to do a volume 2. And we actually sold the film rights to it to Paramount to try to, and that also gives you something that you can like, all right, now it's worth, you know, somebody likes this. Let's go make some more of them and have some more Riptide. And the second volume did really well. So, and hopefully we'll be able to do that with the box and with some of our future stuff like Carriers and Verge that are going to be coming out later this fall.
So I'm going to get to Carriers because I actually was watching a podcast with the writer of that the other day, and that one sounds awesome. Another one of your titles that I don't remember if it showed up on Key, but I know a lot of our customers were super excited about it was it Kira, the one with the monkey?
Zira. Yes, that was also from
the
Argentinian studio we partner with.
Okay.
So and that was one of the first two books. You know, when we were talking with them about what was in the catalog and what we might bring, and that kind of fits into our remit because we're looking for stuff that's generally in PG-13. We do kids books. We have we've had some really cool kids books in the past, and we will have some more in the future that we're working on. Next year you'll see Bjorn, the littlest Viking,
adorable
super Viking who goes and must fight evil trolls and creatures. We do titles from, that you can read and preteen and teen. And service, but still an accessible story up to young adult and into your 20s and 30s. And try to fit stuff into that range. So we had to go through everything that they had that would kind of fit into that remit. And Angela Del Morte and Machine Girl were the two big ones right off the bat. But then the second one was Zira, partly because it has three, these fantastic three interlocking covers of these three. It's about monkeys that have been being experimented on by the U.S. government to make them into weapons. So it's got a little bit of that We Three Project X vibe to it. And then one of the monkeys has a baby, and she doesn't want her baby being experimented on either. So she takes all the weapons that have been built into her and escapes from the military compound, and they send some of their other monkey assassins after her. And it's very, very moving. It's very, very action packed. And I was basically sold on it's a 3-issue series that we're going to be bringing to trade next year. And basically the three covers of the three different monkeys breaking out and being shot at and breaking out of I just love those covers so much, but the stories are great. And I was like, yes, we must do that one. Unfortunately, it came out sort of in the middle of the opening day. We had like three titles that were all solicited for basically quarter two of 2020 when everything shut down and nothing could be distributed or printed or gotten back from the printer, and Zira was one of those. And it was one of the first books up to bat when Diamond reopened and stores, retailers reopened, and everyone was being very, very cautious because either they couldn't have any foot traffic at all or they didn't know what it was going to be. So there are not a whole lot of those floating around because it just came out at a time when demand was very, very low.
Yeah, because I remember even us, I had a few copies of number one, and the next thing I knew, it was sold out, and I'm like, oh my, and Diamond, especially probably because you guys at the time couldn't get it all going, Diamond was sold out too. It was out of stock through Diamond. We couldn't get restocked. So it's like, I'm glad that you guys were able to get it, and it actually looks like through your website, people might be able to grab a couple copies still too while they wait for the trade. So that's awesome.
I do still have some in stock in at the publisher level, and definitely if for some retailers, if anybody, you or any other retailers are listening, you can always come directly to us, and we do direct retailer fulfillment. But anybody who's looking for stuff and whatever reason Diamond's not keeping it in stock can come to red5comics.com and get directly from us. So there is material that Diamond is sold out at Diamond that I still have at the publisher level, so you can find that material, but not Riptide number one.
that one's gone. So the one title, because we've been talking about a bunch of your cool titles, the one title that you guys are absolutely sold out of up until the trade is what you guys have in stock, and it sounds super cool. Zombies of Mass Destruction.
Yeah,
you guys are sold out through the board, 1-6 of all of that. Tell me a little bit about that, because I'm about to go in and put an order for some trades for the people right now.
All right. This is actually one of our earliest books and one of my favorites. So it was written by Kevin Grievous, who wrote the original Underworld films and was the the creator of the Underworld films, and he acts in several of them. He's the large hulking werewolf in them. And so it was, I think it was an idea for a movie script that he was working on, and he was looking at getting, and we met him at the Dallas, what eventually became Dallas Fan Fest, but it was before they sold it. So but we met him at a convention, and he was telling us about several of the movie scripts he was working on, that he was looking at translating into comic books as well, partly to have it as a comic and partly to help him with his pitch. And one of those was, this is 2008, it was Zombies of Mass Destruction, and it was great, and I still love it. And the Army has begun to experiment on using zombies as basically weapons in warfare, with the idea that they can drop them in the middle of the night, they can go and they can decimate the enemy, and then the Army will roll in afterwards, clean out all the zombies, and take over whatever area, and with a lot less, their idea is less casualties, less muss, and less fuss. But of course, when you're dealing with zombies, it doesn't ever work out that way. And next thing you know, you've got this this special forces team that's sort of trapped behind the lines in Iraq, surrounded by zombies, and they've got to get out and get back to the U.S. so they can blow the whistle on this mad scheme that that their superiors have been cooking up. And it's just crazy fun zombie action with automatic weapons and mines and military equipment. And it's great.
I like it. It's like, as you started, like, I don't know why my mind is like, this is Operation Dumbo Drop, but with zombies.
Yeah, it's not far off.
And, you know, many people probably don't even remember that movie. It wasn't great, but, you know.
Come on, Ray Liotta never made a bad movie. What are you talking about?
We could have all survived without Operation Dumbo Drop, I think. but you mentioned it early on when you were talking about like being the co-publisher kind of and what you guys do at Red 5. But it's very clear that you guys aren't just a horror publisher or aren't just a fantasy publisher. I mean, you guys are literally trying to hit all genres here, right?
A little bit of everything. One of my favorite things that we did last year that I've been working on for a while, we actually went and we did some back into old 70s underground comics. We connected with a woman named Willie Mendez, who was a contemporary of Trina Robbins in the 70s. We'd sort of left comics and gone into the fine arts scene, and she's coming back into it. And she had done like her first new book, which is about 40 pages in a long time. So we decided to take that and then take a lot of her old material that had been out of print since the 70s, because it was basically handmade and sold, you know, shop to shop in the days before, you know, in the underground comics days before the direct market was really a thing, and cleaned it up and put together this brand new big art book called Queen of Cosmos Comics, which is what her story is, which is a very strange kind of psychedelic autobiographical tale with a lot of Judeo-Christian religious elements and symbology baked into it. So it's quite a trip, but you know, I thought it was super interesting. I wanted to reach back to get to that kind of history the same way, the same impulse that I had us kind of reach back and bring in Moon Girl and stuff from the 30s. Cause I like all portions of comics from, you know, its inceptions up through all of its strange phages, from the superhero stuff to the EC comic stuff, to old Westerns and Donald Duck comics and all the bits and pieces of it. So, what we published sort of, reflects a lot of that and the breadth of the different stuff that I like.
Nice. And Jennifer says that last one sounds so cool because she's a Christian. She's going to check that out.
Check it out.
Another title I wanted to ask you about, because I thought it was awesome, because we're game comics and game stores, so this is kind of one of those that fits in both. You guys have a Mandrake the Magician book as
That's
well.
That's right. We did an agreement with this, also one of those ones that came out, it came out towards the end of the initial pandemic phase. So around the third quarter of 2020, when everything was reopening, but we had right before the pandemic hit, we had signed an agreement with King Features to bring some of their classic characters like Flash Gordon and Mandrake and the Phantom and whatnot and make new series, reimagined series out of those characters. And the one they really wanted to start with was Mandrake. And they wanted to do a young adult reimagining of Mandrake, focusing on Mandrake's daughter, who would be about 14 or 15. in the series, and about her kind of learning who her father was and trying to decide if she was going to pick up his mantle. And that was Legacy of Mandrake, which was tremendously, you know, well done. A fantastic book. And I'm hoping we get to do more of it. I'm hoping it's the beginning of many new books with game features.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that when I saw Mandrake the Magician, I'm like, oh my God, I kind of rubbed my eyes and said, am I seeing this right? But now it's cool that you guys have been able to team up with other people as well, because, you know, working with IP is a big deal in comics and publishing and stuff like that. So let me ask you, since you guys have been, you said you're about to celebrate 15 years, 2007, how have you seen Red 5 progress over those 15 years? And how has indie comics progressed in those 15 years?
It's expanded, partly because it has to, because the market has definitely changed in small and big ways over 15 years. There were a lot more retail stores in 2007 than there are now. But at the same time, comics itself is probably a larger part of the cultural landscape than it was. 2007 is pre-Iron Man and pre the MCU. And now you have, I think one big thing we've seen is I probably have more direct customer interaction and people coming and looking for new books through cons and conventions than before. They used to be, people went to stores for a lot of their primary whatever when they wanted to read something, and now people go to conventions and bulk up. And I see new people coming in and into comics reading every day. They're just coming in through different mediums. So especially as an indie publisher, as a publisher of any type, it's like, okay, the channels have changed. How do I connect to those new channels and get our material out to them? As far as Red 5, I think we've expanded what Red 5 means. You know, early on, we produced a lot of Atomic Robo early on because it was a great series, and we kind of kept the number of books that we were doing per month and per year fairly small. And I won't say similar, because actually they were very different. We would have like a zombie Western and a pirate book and ZMD and young adult fantasy book like Beautiful Creatures. So it ran the gamut, but it was still, there would only be a couple of extra books. So we have both expanded and are continuing to expand how many titles we're putting out each year, but also expanding further and further into what those can be, into doing things like not just IP, but doing things like underground comics like Queen of Cosmos, and doing things like our agreement with Stonebot and bringing in some of these more out there books that you might normally think of as sort of European science fiction titles, something you might see in heavy metal, and bringing in, making that part of the Red 5 experience.
That's really cool too, how you mentioned, the deal with the Argentinian Stonebot and going to Europe, you know, because I'm in a lot of groups in indie comics, you know, like Kickstarter level and stuff like that. And I'm seeing a lot of great stuff coming out of Europe. It's just the shipping prices, you know, to do a Kickstarter for Europe and get it sent to the US stinks a little bit. But there's some great art over there. The styles are different and the storytelling is a little different, but it's still comic books and there's a lot of good stuff out there. And I'm glad that publishers here in the States are trying to bring that over here. And then the translation thing is awesome as well, because it's something that exists in a different language and now we're making it, you know, we do that with media the other way everywhere, you know, things go from English to that. So it's really cool to see you guys doing that.
Yeah.
Another, one of the titles that, cause it's historical might not be the right word, but you guys also have Chasing Hitler. Tell me a little bit about that. Cause I know there's been a lot of like Hitler documentaries lately, and actually dealing with Argentina and things like that. So tell me about Chasing Hitler.
So Chasing Hitler, actually the story behind Chasing Hitler to me is almost or more interesting than Chasing Hitler itself. Although the book is great. The book itself is sort of a what if, historical action adventure fiction. What if Hitler had faked his death in the bunker and had escaped from Germany? And you have these two commandos, a British and American commando, who have discovered that, and none of their superiors believe them, so they go AWOL to go chase, go to Argentina to chase Hitler down to South America and try to bring him back to settle for his crimes. And it was actually brought to us at San Diego one year by a 16-year-old girl who wrote it. And she wanted to be she was at that time a junior in high school. And she wanted to be a comic book writer. So she brought us a finished first issue that she had written and gone through Kickstarter and gotten connected with several artists and gotten them to get finished the first book. And we kind of connected like, all right, so what, you know, and saw what her story was for the first four issues. Like, all right, if you can get the rest of it done, we will publish it. And she got it done. And I think she was a freshman in college by the time it actually came out, but she got it done and put it out. And it's just a fantastic that somebody, you know, that, you know, with that skill level, I did not have either the skill or the make how to actually get a full series, a comic book series made when I was a junior in high school, but she did. So that was quite something.
Yeah. When I was a junior in high school, I don't think I was doing any of that stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, and it's funny, I actually look, you guys and Scout have one cool thing in common is that, like, you guys have both kind of fostered a really young comic creator's career, because with that story of Chasing Hitler, and then Scout has done Seda Wolf, who at 15 mm-hmm. years old wrote, drew, and lettered her own comic. Mm-hmm. And I think that's awesome, not just because, oh, it's a cool story that you guys, you know, helped a kid achieve their dream. That's the future of the industry in a lot mm-hmm. of cases, you know, like, for yeah. all we know, they could go and write the next 20 books for, you know,
so.
We all know, you know, they could write the next Saga or the next Invincible. Mm-hmm. You guys are kind of fostering that. I know that obviously your goal isn't to find the newest and youngest talent, but I mean, mm-hmm. it's got to be really cool when you kind of find somebody that literally their first ever published work is with you guys.
It is. I love that. That was a great feeling to be able to try to help somebody get into, you know, get through the door and get their first books out and go out and get whatever their next books are. Is great, and always looking for the next person who's looking for that same helping hand and has got that same next great work that is ready for the world to see.
For sure, and it's awesome. You guys are doing important work, just allowing those people to get a little bit further, because, you know, you could do a lot of things with your college, you know, dissertation mm-hmm. and with your Kickstarter, but, like, getting it in Diamond is that extra step, you know, mm-hmm. that a lot of people might not ever get to. So that's really awesome. Actually, while we have actually, Jennifer just mentioned Travis, and we love yeah. Travis. I yeah. don't think we're allowed to talk about Travis today. But
I'm talking to Travis.
We're talking to Travis,
and hopefully, very soon we'll be. I will come back, and we can talk about stuff.
Yeah,
like we're gonna do with Travis.
What are other future like titles releasing in the next month or so, or that are currently in Diamond that you guys have coming out here in the future? Yeah.
So Verge, number one, is in Diamond right now, and it's going to be in stores in September. It's this great science fiction action story from a young writer in Australia. And the idea is that someone in the not too distant future has invented a time machine and has actually been gathering refugees from the past from natural disasters that would have killed them. So he brought forward like a bunch of like Roman citizens from Mount Vesuvius and some Chinese groups who have been wiped out by the Mongols and some Vikings who were fighting with the Romans and cavemen and that sort of thing, and is bringing them, you know, to the future as survivors. And so now you have this collection of different time refugees who have settled in New York City, all with different backgrounds and different cultures, who now have to live in relatively close proximity to each other. So it's taken the melting pot of New York to the next level. And you have a specialized task force within the NYPD whose job is just to police the time refugees and keep them from fighting with each other or fighting with any of the other people who live in New York. But then someone starts killing the different groups of time refugees, and one of the detectives thinks it's a serial killer specifically targeting the time refugees, and no one believes her. And so now she's trying to find out why someone is specifically targeting them and who it is and what they want, which begins to lead back to the questions of why was this time machine built? Why were these people brought back to the future? And where did the inventor and its time machine go? Because at one point it just people stopped appearing and they couldn't send anyone back to the past. The machinery was all gone, and these people are all stuck here in future New York, and which is why they have this bureau to begin with. So it's a really, really great mind trippy time travel adventure, or with a lot of like police procedural elements kind of mixed together. It works really well.
Nice. And you said that comes out in September, right?
That's right. Yeah.
So that's the Verge. We'll definitely have that here in stores, guys. That sounds awesome. We're also, as soon as we get off here, I'll definitely be putting in an order on Red 5 directly. So we'll have a lot of their number one titles and trade paperbacks in the store. But Josh, as we're wrapping up, is there anything else you wanted to talk about? Where can people find you or Red 5? If they're trying to follow you guys on social media, what can they check you guys out at?
So you look for us on, Twitter and Instagram at Red 5 Comics. You can find me on Twitter at Josh Starnes Film or Instagram at JB Starnes 1. And you're going to see a timeline full of like new covers for new Red 5 books all the time. Come to our website, red5comics.com. We have a newsletter you can subscribe to that comes out usually every Wednesday. You can get advanced looks at new number ones that are coming out, as well as opportunities for specialized sales for material from our web store that other people won't get access to, and occasionally some low print run variants as well, just for our subscribers. So come and check out the newsletter as well.
Awesome, Josh. Well, thank you so much for stopping by, man. I know we're going to have you. It's awesome to have another co-publisher on the show. I know we'll definitely be having you back. The Verge comes out, or actually the box.
Out now.
By you yourself. Mm-hmm. We will have some more of those once I can get Red 5 to drop me some here. And then the Verge will be in September here at the store or any LCS. You can add it to your poll. Go ahead and do that. Josh, thank you so much, man. We'll see you around. Right. Thanks for coming on the show today.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So thank you so much to Josh and Red 5 Comics, and a little shout out to Travis Gibb for hooking us up. I didn't know Josh prior to this, but Red 5, I was looking through their catalog before we got here. Awesome books. I wanted to ask him about some of the ones that I plan on carrying in the store. So look for a lot of those books, like including Zombies of Mass Destruction. We're going to have the trade of that, because like I said, all the issues are sold out. But we're going to have a ton of Red 5 stuff, future and past, in the store. Thank you again to Josh, Red 5 Comics. This has been the Collective Spotlight. We'll be back here again tomorrow, 5:30 p.m. with the $1 auction. Max has a bunch of cool stuff that he just found, but I'm not going to lie to you. The gem of the show is going to be the life story of great American Dwight D. Eisenhower, so that you can get that for as little as $1 tomorrow, guys. But take it easy. We'll be back 5:30 tomorrow, and then 5:30 on Tuesday with another